Hi, this is Major Tom Photo Lab. Today we have a Vega 12 lens that needs its aperture fixed. This lens was produced by the Arsenal factory in Ukraine for Kyiv medium format cameras. In case you haven't heard of medium format, simply put, it's the one that is larger than full frame. Consequently, it can be used both on full frame and APS-C. Soviet-made medium-format lenses are usually very cheap, yet they produce great images because we'll be only using the middle part of the lens, which usually renders best quality. The Arsenal manufacturer can be easily identified by the font used for captions. It's very typical. And the logo, of course, which this lens, for some reason, does not have. A certain confusion arises from the naming of this unit. The character that goes after the numeral is the Russian letter B. Finally, the Latin letter B Vega 12 also exists. It's the same lens with a different bayonet. Evidently, someone at the factory wasn't thoughtful enough to use Latin letters as indices, so they had to keep Cyrillic characters along with the name spelled in English. To stop confusion, from now on I'm gonna call them B and Russian B. The Russian B version has Pentacon 6 mount. The B version has Hasselblad mount. So, if you're out to buy some medium format Soviet lenses, try to get the Russian B version, since Hasselblad adapters are either hard to find or pricey. I modified some B lenses for Nikon too, though, with the help of my 3D printer. Please see link in the description if interested. Now, this particular one was sold for half price. The description stated that aperture was stuck. I kind of hoped the problem was aperture control shaft, similar to what Helios 44 has, which would be a very easy fix. Since I'll be using the lens with my Nikon D7000, I just figured I'd get rid of the thing altogether. So let us take the unit apart and get our hands dirty. There is a simple rule for tearing down any lens. If possible, try to first separate the optical unit from the helicoid. If you do the helicoid instead, especially if you don't need to, it might be a nightmare to reassemble, so you gotta watch out for this one. In many vintage lenses, you can just unscrew the front part by hand. It is the case here, but turns out it's not the entire optical unit, it's just the glare-reducing part, sort of a built-in hood, which you can also find in Helios 44. Gotta do some more cleaning here. Okay. So we have to disassemble the unit from the back. Here's another piece of advice. Lenses use tiny bolts of different length and diameter. Do not mix them up. As you dig deeper, store bolts in separate boxes chronologically. Then, as you reassemble the unit, just retrieve them and put back in reverse order. That's a time saver. There are some cryptic messages here. No idea what they mean. It appears the shaft and drive are okay. We gotta proceed. There's the spacer ring. It's used to fine-tune flange distance at the factory. And here is the helicoid. It has built-in limiters, which is good. Some Arsenal lenses, like Mir 20, have limiters on the bayonet ring, and once you remove that, the helicoid goes completely loose and can be unscrewed by mistake, which is exactly what we do not want. We can separate the optical part now. And the helicoid still has its limiters intact. Lovely. The aperture is inside this assembly. To actually access the blades, we need to remove the rear lens. And here they are. As far as I know, Arsenal was the only Soviet manufacturer to produce shiny aperture blades, which, as we know, was not such a great idea. Reflective blades cause ghosting and poor contrast. So, I can move the blades with my tweezers. However, for the unit to function properly, the aperture must retract by itself, which, as we can see, is not happening. The unit has a spring that's supposed to take care of that, but obviously it does not provide enough pull. The reason is oil on the blades, which is commonly caused by age and heat exposure. We're gonna need to take the aperture unit apart and clean it. In most cases, it's quite easy to remove the blades. Just make sure you don't bend them. And we can see the aperture drive system is working. The drive consists of a rotating disc and an external ring that is fixed to the lens body. Each blade has two guides. One goes into the fixed part, the other into the disc. As the disc rotates, the blades engage and retract. And that's basically how aperture works. Here I use lighter fluid to wash the blades. It's better not to touch them with bare hands. I will clean the drive too. We can see the blades dry themselves very quickly and are ready for installation. Now, the aperture is rumored to be the most difficult unit to reassemble. That's mostly true. What you basically have to do is install the blades one by one in this fashion, which is easy. And it even appears the whole thing is working. But the hard part comes when you try to put in the last blade. Turns out, its pointy end has to go above the blade next to it, but the hinge must go underneath. Look at the other blades to get the idea. From what I know, it's next to impossible to assemble the unit that way. So, when assembling any aperture, what you have to do is separate the central disc from the outer ring of the drive system. In some lenses, these parts are on different sides of the blades. In this lens, they are on the same side, but the external ring is removable. So let us unscrew the three bolts. Remember to store them separately, like I said. What we do now is lay out the blades on the external ring. Note that they have to go in counterclockwise direction so that the pointy parts face us. And let us put in the last blade. It's not that easy anyway, but at least it's doable. If you're still confused about where and how exactly it needs to go, just look at the other blades, and you'll get the idea. Now, let us test all the blades to make sure they've gotten into their hinges. Looks good. Make sure the blades clear the ring diameter, otherwise the unit won't fit into place. What we have to do now is pick the whole thing up gently and lower it into place. There's a small notch on the side of the cylinder that obviously serves this purpose. Let's use it. We're almost done. Now we gotta do a little bit more magic for the blades to lock in place. Just take your time. There we go. Now the spring can manage the blades all right. As the whole thing is quite easy to wreck, let us put the lens assembly back as soon as possible. Working. We did it. The front lens unit has some dirt. Let us clean it. I will use the lens removal tool. Another piece of advice. Since the glasses are very easy to scratch, do not use the tool all the way. Just apply it to loosen the nut. Once done, put it away and use some plastic tool to finish up or your hand. To retrieve the lens, I will use suction tool. Looking good. Rear lenses can use some cleaning too. We got two of them here. Each lens is supposed to go the way it was, so do the spacers. You can make a drawing or a video recording. Okay. Let us now put the whole thing together. Compared to what we've done, that one is easy. One more thing. I want to get rid of the aperture drive shaft. Good. This is the aperture ring click switch. If your primary lens usage is shooting videos, you might want to not install this key, but I will for now. Also make sure you align these. Not much left to do here. The limiter key has to match the red mark on the depth of field scale. And we're done. Our beautiful aperture is working. Time to go shoot some pictures. So there you have it. If you find this video useful, I'd appreciate it if you wrote a comment and liked it. This channel is dedicated to lens review, repair, and modification. Please leave your questions in the comments section below. If you're interested in purchasing equipment demonstrated in this video, the links can be also found there. This was Major Tom Photo Lab. Be good, and thanks for watching.